If you live in the Pacific Northwest, you've probably wondered, what would it be like to experience a major earthquake? Let's lay out the scenario. It's Wednesday in May, and you're working from home in South King County. It's around 11:30 a.m. when you feel it.
There's been a massive earthquake.
The building's gonna fall.
For the next 4 minutes, your family, along with 2.2 million other people around Puget Sound, will experience a 9.1 earthquake. How well you've prepared for these 4 minutes will change the course of your family's life forever.
Experts predict that if you live in our region for the next 50 years, there's a more than 1 in 3 chance you'll experience a major earthquake. According to native oral histories and records from Japan, our region's last big quake happened in the year 1700. It's believed that entire villages on Vancouver Island were wiped off the map. Over the next few minutes, my colleagues from the Office of Emergency Management will illustrate what an earthquake scenario might look like today for a family living just south of Seattle. Let's begin in the immediate aftermath of the quake.
It's a Wednesday morning, and a massive 9.1 earthquake has just occurred. When the shaking began, your husband was at work in Pioneer Square, your son was at school, and you and your elderly mother were at home. The damage across the entire region is severe. Buildings toppled, down power lines, roads blocked with debris. Things are chaotic, but your family has a plan in place. You agreed that if a major emergency like this ever happened, you'd all rendezvous back at your house. Now is the time to execute your plan. Since you were at home when the quake happened, your first priority is to check in on your elderly mom. The inside of your house is a mess. Toppled bookshelves, glass from picture frames. Luckily, both of you took cover and were not injured by falling objects. Next, you take a minute to check around the outside of the house, looking at your gas meter, electrical lines, surrounding trees and homes. The damage is bad, but you don't smell gas leaking and there aren't any downed wires or immediate threats to your home. Having checked your home and made sure your mom is safe, it's time to walk to pick up your son from school. And don't forget to bring along a small backpack of emergency supplies as you leave the house. The staff at your son's elementary school has activated their emergency procedures. It's likely you will need to show identification to establish your relationship as his parent in order to pick him up. Once you, your son, and your mom are back at home, it's time to begin to gather your long-term emergency supplies while you wait for your husband to make his way home from downtown Seattle. At street level, the damage in Pioneer Square is severe. Many of the older, unreinforced brick buildings have collapsed. The roads are nearly impassable. Luckily, your husband was delivering a package at an earthquake-reinforced building, and he survived the initial quake. He slowly walks out of downtown, stopping to assist others where he can, but steadily making his way south and east. He stops at a friend's house in the Beacon Hill neighborhood and borrows a bicycle. It's late in the afternoon, but he finally makes it back home. Your family is reunited. Now it's time to begin the hard work of surviving the weeks ahead.
It's hard for any one person or family to be totally prepared for an emergency. Meeting your neighbors beforehand and coming together to support each other during a crisis is essential for your community's well-being.
It's been 2 weeks since a major earthquake turned life upside down. Power remains out, water has not yet been restored, and grocery stores are empty. Preparations you made before the quake have helped you survive this emergency. You and your family are currently living in your backyard, where you've set up a large camping tent, cooking stove, and latrine. You were able to salvage 10 days worth of food from your pantry, and you've drained your hot water heater to provide water for drinking and cooking. You also had an extra supply of diabetes medication on hand for your elderly mother. While you and your family have done many things right, you've also had some unexpected close calls over the past 2 weeks. Your husband was cleaning up some broken glass around your home when he sliced open his hand, a serious enough injury that might have sent him to the urgent care during normal times. One of your neighbors, a retired nurse, was able to clean and treat the wound on site. Another problem, your family's food supply ran out after 10 days. Luckily, community members came together to share resources and establish an emergency food pantry on your block. you've also done your part to chip in. As a fluent Spanish speaker, you've been checking in regularly on your older neighbor who isn't fluent in English. Surviving for 2 weeks has been challenging, but working together with your neighbors, things aren't as bad as they could be.
So far, you've survived the immediate aftermath and worked with your neighbors to overcome challenges. Let's see where things stand 2 months later.
It's been 2 months since the initial quake. Food banks have been activated, electricity is slowly returning, and water is available. Your family and most of your neighbors were able to shelter in place. Tens of thousands of other families had to take shelter in temporary mass housing. Over 13,000 people died in the initial quake, and another 27,000 were injured. It will be years before the region fully recovers. Your family and neighbors were prepared, and you worked hard to support each other throughout this emergency.
It can be scary to think about what might happen in a worst-case scenario earthquake. At the same time, thinking through an emergency event can help you and your loved ones get prepared. Remember, if you live in our region for the next 50 years, there's a 1 in 3 chance you'll experience a major earthquake. The Office of Emergency Management has resources available to help you start preparing today.